Way right down to the rock bottom. Way right. first time I met them would have been like 1959 going into 1960. I know it was either at the close of 59 or the beginning of 1960. Long, long time ago, and they were more or less just out of school back then. Kids playing for fun in the cabin club in Liverpool, and which then was a damp, filthy basement hole. It was a horrid place to go, but it was a jazz club with some reputation, and I'd visit there quite often with various of the jazz groups I'd be guesting with back in those days, whether it be Akabelk or Chris Barber or whatever. And quite frequently, the Beatles were our intermission band there. Quite what they had to do with jazz per se, I think it was probably because they were friends of the management of the club. But anyway, they would seem to be on the bill at any given time that I'd be there. And we became quite friendly back in those days. And I kind of interested, started them off in their interest in the blues. Most of those early days were in the Cavern Club. I didn't really see them in London until the time that we did the television show Around the Beatles, which Brian Epstein produced, Jack Good directed. And they had only just made the move from Liverpool to London a month or two before we did that particular show. That we did that May 1964. Well, they remembered me doing Muddy's old song, Muddy Waters' song. I got my mojo working. I remembered that back from the early days, because that was part of my repertoire from zillions of years ago. And they remember me doing that in the Cavern Club, and they said, well, we'd love to have Baldry on that show, but he must do I've Got My Mojo Working. So I was happy to oblige. And very nicely, they provided the vocal backup on the chorus.
Yeah. baby, giving me some advice. I got a gypsy woman. Oh, she's giving me some advice. I got a whole lot of tricks down here. Oh, now, yes, that I'm keeping here on ice.
Residency, and it was very successful for some weeks. And during our early weeks there, Mick Jagger and Keith Richard came down and joined us. You know, got up on the stage for a jam. And from time to time, Brian Jones also traveled in from Cheltenham, which is in the west part of England. And Mick really did have a very positive effect on the band. A good singer. People in the audience liked him very much because they could identify with him, because the audience in the main was more or less Mick's age, 17, 18, student crowd. Jagger, always from the word go, had a certain thing about him that set him apart from other people. He was not such a good mover as he is today back then. He was a bit stiff and awkward. But nevertheless, there was this charisma about him that did appeal to those very early audiences we had.
The Steeler!
Now the sun was shining, he opened his
gonna suffer from your bad attitude. You say you love me, but I do it all. And so you keep me up against the wall. Oh, baby, I've got better things to do. I'm not the reason you got a bad attitude. In the morning and carrying on like a little child. You try so hard to get what you want. You're driving me wild. Sick and tired of the way you do. Long John has got to put a spell on you. Sprinkle goofer dust round your bed. You're gonna wake up in the morning, find your own self dead. All right. Better get rid of your bad attitude, child. Not the reason you got a bad attitude. Yes, I'm not the reason you got a bad attitude. I am not the reason you got a bad attitude. I am not the reason you got a bad attitude. Oh, son! You got a bad attitude, bitch!
At one time, lived in Germany, and he was in, aside from his musical things, he was employed as a booking agent. The Liverpool bands were extremely popular in Hamburg for whatever reasons, and the Beatles were among a rotation of artists that were being bussed and ferried over from England. And Roy was the, you know, the man who put it all together. And very often he'd join in with the Beatles and, you know, be playing piano because they never had their own piano player. And he was offered a position shortly after Brian Epstein became their manager, saying, how would you like to be, you know, regularly with the band playing piano? And Roy turned it down. He was happier with the security of his booking agent job.
When I saw her stand there, she was just something. You know what I mean? The way she looked was really a company. How can I dance with another? When I saw you standing there, well, she looked
more time. Come on, son.
When I saw.
Come on, come on.
When I saw you stand, stand. Oh, when I saw you stand, stand. One more. When I saw you stand, stand. Oh, all right. Oh, yeah. Oh.
It was a song I was very honored and privileged to play with a man, one of my greatest rock and roll people in the world, Little Richard. And he did a song called A Whole Lot of Shaking.
Became Elton John, of course. At that particular time, I had a thing about gambling. I loved being up all night playing poker. I loved roulette and all kinds of different games. I wasn't really heavily into craps, but I enjoyed gambling. And I lived at that particular time around the corner from a gambling casino in London called the Cromwellian Club. So one particular night, I was, you know, feeling a bit bored or a little bit stiff from sitting at the table so long, that I went down to the discotheque area and saw this band performing. The band was called Bluesology. And sitting at the keyboard chair was Reginald Kenneth Dwight. And they impressed me so much that I asked them to join me on a tour that I was starting about a month or 6 weeks from that particular evening. And he was with me and the band in various shapes and sizes for about 2 years. And the spring, early summer of 1968, he had an offer from Dick James, music publishing company, who of course published all the Beatles hits with the Northern Songs company. He had an offer from Dick James Music to go in there and write his own songs in unlimited recording facilities. And he was very, very into, you know, getting, you know, developing as a writer, and had just met Bernie Taupin. And so he left the band. But in leaving the band, he wasn't sure what to call himself, because Reginald Kenneth Dwight is not exactly the name you want to be lumbered with. So we were sitting on a plane, I remember it so well, going from Glasgow to London. We'd been playing at Glasgow University, I think. And he said, what am I going to call myself? Now, in the band, we had a saxophone player at that time called Elton Dean, who later went on to form the band Soft Machine. We thought, well, Elton, that's a good name. So we took the Elton from Elton Dean and the John from John Baldry, and Elton John was born on that plane flight.
tell you what I thought I heard this morning. After I heard a young boy crying for his mama. After I heard a young boy crying for his mama today. You wouldn't hear no young boy crying for his mama. You wouldn't hear no young boy crying for his mama. Walk behind in the morning, dear, my baby. Walk behind in the morning, dear, dear. I would have walked you out in the morning, dear, my baby. I would have walked you out in the morning, do it all. Don't let there ain't no more morning, dear, my baby. Now there ain't no more morning, dear, today. I wouldn't walk you right in the morning, dear, my baby. I wouldn't walk you out in the morning, dear, my baby. Walk me out in the morning dew. Walk me out in the morning dew. Walk me out in the morning dew. Walk me out in the morning.
Rod Stewart, I first met the evening of January the 4th, 1964, which was shortly before Rod's 19th birthday. I think his birthday is the 10th of January, yep. Anyway, so I'm standing on the platform at Twickenham Station. Very foggy, very cold night. And I hear the sound of this blues harmonica playing, and it was, you know, the riff from the Howling Wolf song, Smokestack Lightning. I thought, well, that sounds pretty good. Let me go and investigate. So I walked down the other end of the platform and see this, what looked like a pile of coats and a great big scarf around the top of it and a nose poking through the top. And it was indeed Mr. Stewart. So I said, well, that sounded pretty good. Play me some more while we're waiting for the train. And then we got chatting, and we were going to be performing at Ilpi Island again that Tuesday night. So he had been down to see us that night. I said, well, why don't you come down again on Tuesday and get up with the band and have a play? Which he did. Totally terrified. Very, very nervous about the whole thing. I don't think the audience was too impressed at this first outing of his, but there was something about him on that stage, and I thought, well, you got the makings of something good here. And in fact, that particular night, the Tuesday after I met him, I said, well, you know, why don't you come on the road with us?
Oh, when my tears come a-streaming down along the Lord, when there's trouble, I'm gonna do the same. Ow!
I feel that I am a person blessed in many ways. I've been very, very lucky. I've been doing what I do for most part of 28 years now. And the feeling of joy and elation that I had from what I did back then, I still have now. I think that's the only reason I keep on doing it. It's surely not because of the building a career thing or the financial thing. Lord knows I could have chosen easier things in life to do. But I just love what I do so much.
The ocean. I am soaring back home to the place I was born and raised. I'm flying across the mountains and the valleys. I'm back home to the ones that I love so much. Don't blame me if I'm feeling homesick. For such a very long, long time. Suffered once in the county jail. Oh, that I feel sorry. I was hungry, I was tired, and poor, yes, I was. I was born and raised, lying across the mountains and the valleys. I'm back home to the ones that I love so much.
Oh, and love, yes, I was falling in love with your buttons and bows.
And on, I guess I was falling in love with your buttons and bows. I guess I was falling in love, yeah, with your buttons and bows.
for a couple of grams. I live on the front of promised land.